CTV program in color.
Welcome to W5, and a very special edition of a program that was launched on a young CTV television network on September 11th, 1966. We're starting at an important place in the history of the show, Toronto's Nathan Phillips Square. We'll show you why in a moment. Tonight we celebrate 50 years of telling stories that informed, inspired, and occasionally annoyed millions of Canadians from coast to coast to coast. Half a century ago, Toronto City Hall was 1 year old, and this was the scene of W5's first story. The idea was to show how easy it was to buy a rifle, take it to a public place, and shoot people at random.
In Canada, this 15-year-old boy is not allowed to enter a bar and buy a drink, yet he can walk into a store and buy a gun. Then the boy wrapped the gun, and he headed for the Toronto City Hall. Police on guard outside didn't even give him a second glance. So, two elevator rides later, our make-believe sniper arrived on the observation tower, 27 stories above one of the busiest intersections in the city. It was only when he began to unwrap the gun that people noticed him. And possibly by then, it would have been too late.
No shots were fired. No carnage in Toronto.
But it basically showed, look, you think it can't happen in this country? It certainly can happen in Canada. It really is a kind of journalism that at that point in 1966, I think Canadians were really not expecting. There had been, shootings in Texas at a college, with a gunman in a bell tower. And that's the kind of journalism, and what a great way to kind of say, hey, we're going to be aggressive, we're going to tell stories. Hidden cameras, we've continued to use them over the years, but challenging conventional wisdoms. And I think that's really what that story shows. And the show hasn't looked back since then.
Take me for a trip upon your magic swirling ship.
All my W5 grabbed attention. It was bold and provocative, and viewers loved it. Here's Doug Johnson in 1967, grilling a Japanese pilot who took part in the bombing of Pearl Harbor.
Which you said a moment ago, the people who were at Pearl Harbor who flew the planes had a pride in what they had done. But can you tell me whether those who were in the army and ran the prison camps, are they proud of their role in the Second World War?
I want not to have this program.
You better cut it. This is no good.
I'm back.
It's too much of a strain on this thing. See, you're making him grovel there that way, and it isn't right.
I'm not making him grovel.
Oh, man, if you only knew.
W5's cameras took viewers to places they'd never seen, raised questions that had never been asked. Our first female reporter, Trina McQueen, scored a scoop with an interview inside a women's prison.
Are you learning anything here that's going to help you when you get out?
Well, that's going to help me when I get out. I guess it'll help me if I want to come back, I guess.
McQueen moved on to be an executive at the CBC and eventually president of CTV. But in those early days, women still faced the kind of sexism that would never be tolerated now.
Well, I did my job interview in a sauna. The executive producer welcomed me to his home, took me downstairs into the sauna, and the job interview was done. And we were both clothed before, after, and during the interview. And his wife was doing the laundry just a little way over. And I thought later, you know, that's kind of a W5 thing. Put you in a situation where you're kind of put off. Stick you into something that's a bit strange and a bit different. See how you react. Can you deal with circumstances that are difficult and strange? Because that's what W5 was about.
In the 1960s, Canada was changing rapidly, and the program became a snapshot of the times.
How do these kids get marijuana? In a variety of ways, really, and it isn't all that difficult to obtain. Just listen to this man.
Sold it in smaller quantities?
Yes.
And some of these were high school age?
Yes, definitely.
Definitely.
They definitely went to high school.
This is part of a seal hunt observed by the New Brunswick SPCA. Don't panic, because this method of killing or stunning and then stripping the pelt off the animal is absolutely approved.
Now, how do you feel about changing the way that you kill seals? And in fact, are you going to do it?
How are you going to change it?
We have to do it, because we have to abide by the law.
Scenes like that shocked viewers and turned the seal hunt into a major debate.
All the journalism in the world doesn't matter unless people see it and do something about it. Our job is to tell the stories. It's the job of the audience to make the changes.
W5 raised other issues as well, where the mere mention of a certain subject could shock and provoke discussion.
I'm considered, I suppose, an easy life, because I like to go to bed.
That it is very important to me, following my Christian faith, that I stay as a virgin, or that the girl that I marry is.
Things that everybody knew were often kept secret, and programs like W5 started beating at that culture of secrecy.
It was with shock and almost disbelief that Canadians learned this week that a person in this country can go to prison for life for something which isn't even a crime in Britain, for homosexuality, in fact.
It seems incredible now, but in 1967, homosexual acts were still illegal. W5 covered the case of Everett Clippert, the last person in Canada to be convicted and jailed for being what was described as an incurable homosexual.
If we find that there is anything to be gained by transferring him to another institution where a highly skilled professional psychiatric treatment is available, he will be transferred.
Well, I think that detaining Everett Clippert in the Saskatchewan penitentiary is tantamount to sentencing a rapist to a harem.
The reforms that led to the legalization of homosexuality in 1969 were a direct result of the public outrage at Clippert's treatment.
Not long after the broadcast, the then Justice Minister, future Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau, says the state has no business in the bedrooms of the nation, and our whole view towards gay and communities has changed, and now we're at a situation where Pierre Trudeau's son, Justin, the Prime Minister, marches in a pride parade.
And as the 60s ended, other long-standing notions of sexuality and family began to crumble.
A typical family, with one major difference. It's a lesbian family. The mother, Cheryl. She loves kids, so she picked a father, also homosexual, got pregnant and had a kid. She'd like to have another child and plans to be artificially inseminated when she can afford it. Her lover, Diane.
George had never been happy as a boy growing up in the Bronx or as an army private for 2 years in wartime. He had always wanted to be a girl. But it wasn't until after a sex change operation that he told his parents about his secret wish come true. He did that in a letter once he had become a she.
And then I just said, I'm your daughter. Shock, shock. Surprise, surprise.
You've been accused of promoting promiscuity. Well,
I assume you've been to bed with more than one woman.
I certainly hope so. Maybe within the last 24 hours, I can't remember.
From swinging lifestyles to alternative lifestyles, W5 rode the crest of the waves of change. But what really rooted the program in the minds of viewers was the impact of its investigative reporting. Unsolved murders, unsafe vehicles, and scams of every description.
This, for me, is the first document which was...
First, a con man made up a story about Dr. Dumoubid owing him money and filed these phony documents in court to prove it. How was it enforced? The courts handed Dumoubid's house over to the con man to cover the phony debt. The con man immediately put the house up for sale. The whole time, Dumoubid had no idea this was happening until the for sale sign went up on his lawn.
Gordon is thrown from the U-Haul. He is crushed to death when the truck flips on him. The driver of the truck pled guilty to careless driving. Gordon's mother and his teenage daughter, Carol, are left behind, tormented by one question. Why would a big company like U-Haul rent out a truck with a seatbelt that didn't work? Scarborough General Hospital in Toronto, one of this country's busiest. Gynecologist Dr. Richard Austin operated on women here for decades. Many of those women have discovered that medical staff in this hospital knew about serious problems with Austin's surgical and post-operative complications, while they, the patients, were kept in the dark.
You think you should have known?
Yeah, most certainly, because when I'm on that table and they put that needle in my arm and knock me out, my life is in his hands.
Dr. Austin, my name is Victor Malarek. I'm with CTV W5. Is there a possibility to talk to you about your cases and about the College of Physicians and Surgeons?
And that's become the long-anticipated moment in countless W5 stories. A face-to-face confrontation with someone who has eluded requests for an interview.
We want to talk about those crimes in the 1980s.
Just because someone says, my cabinet minister will not speak to you, or some guy writes and says, I'm not saying anything. No. People expect answers. And I really believe that when something has gone awry or askew, that we have the responsibility to our viewers to get answers.
That evening, armed with a hidden tape recorder, Kathy approaches the house.
It's known in the business as the doorstop or the jump, or what our legal counsel prefers to call an unscheduled interview.
Is that here?
He's not here, no.
Is he coming in?
No, he's not coming in.
He's not coming in?
Victor, you have perfected this technique. So what's your secret?
The secret really is in planning. You've got to plan the whole thing out because, you know, we'll try to figure out where that person is, who that person is, get the cameraman and sound man aligned and get ready to come out of that vehicle and say, I'm Victor Malarek, I'm with CTV W5, and I've just ruined your day.
Pastor Andrew, I want to know, can we talk to you at all? Well, that's interesting.
Well, she says you physically roughed her up, Mr. Hembroth. She says as a union president, you wouldn't represent her. Now, what's your side of the story? Because I'm sure you have a side to tell.
You were convicted here of making false, misleading, and deceptive consumer representations.
Wait. First of all, sir, what you're saying is definitely not correct. Tell me who called you to come here to see me. Please tell me that. Please tell me why you are here.
I am here because of this condition.
And who other person, how'd you know I'm here? Who asked you to come here and see me?
I found out you were here.
Tell me how you found out.
I dig around.
Next.
And carried me out, 100 feet into the middle of the lake.
Why did you get involved in this investigation?
It's an industry that is kept out of the public eye.
Animals can enrich our lives in so many ways, and one of W5's trademarks has been exploring that relationship. It can inspire and delight, but there's also a darker side. These orangutans thrive in a safe, protected environment here at the Toronto Zoo. But in the wild, they're a critically endangered species. Only 7,500 survive in their natural habitat on the island of Sumatra. And human beings are the reason for that. And it doesn't only happen in faraway places. Closer to home, some people look on animals as a resource to be exploited. W5 finds those people and exposes them to the public.
A face of modern farming, a living production line. Thousands of pregnant sows that never see natural light, spending their lives confined and immobile inside gestation crates. This undercover video, taken by an animal welfare investigator wearing a hidden camera, W5 has agreed to protect his identity.
Why did you get involved in this investigation?
It's an industry that is kept out of the public eye.
On a few occasions, he would grab the calf's head in his hand and shove it into the milk bowl.
Jeff Erton is a farm animal specialist with the SPCA in British Columbia. For the last 9 years, Erton has studied how farm animals are handled in Canada.
Anybody watching this knows that this is an unacceptable way to keep animals.
He's been away from home for 6 months now, going to work 5, sometimes 6 days a week, a job he hates, in a place of mechanized slaughter. One of the largest chicken slaughterhouses in Canada. A few of the things the undercover video shows. Birds hanging by one leg instead of two.
others whose heads missed a machine designed to stun them, whose throats missed a blade designed to kill them, still alive and flapping. Birds arriving at the facility on open trucks, dead because of the way they're transported.
W5 investigations uncover cruelty, but we also explore the extraordinary bond between humans and animals.
You ready to go home, sweetie?
Avian and equine experts, anesthetists, doctors who work with mammals, malamutes, and mice, you name it, they're here. More than 100 veterinarians, clinicians, technicians, all animal lovers, most with pets of their own. Luna is much more than a pet. She's one of 37 psychiatric service dogs, most of them rescued from animal shelters, and now part of a remarkable program developed in Manitoba by George Leonard, a certified dog trainer, to help soldiers like Jeff with PTSD.
She would see me with a beard, and she would come up and tell me, "Daddy, Daddy, only one more." And it was really hard for me. You can sense that I'm having a hard time.
It's autumn, so their bellies are as full as their muscles. Their long, scraggly manes have never been trimmed, so they flop as they gallop. These are highly territorial horses, as all wild animals are. They travel as families, connected to each other. They have never felt a human hand. A living reminder of a time when hundreds of thousands of their kind roam these very same forests and grasslands, a link to a vanishing spirit of wild horses.
W5 has often helped to change lives for the better, animal and human. Our stories have even altered the way we are governed. In the early 1990s, Eric Malling took the program in a new direction.
The first thing to go might well be politics, the old-fashioned kind, handouts and bailouts to make jobs no matter what the cost or value.
His gift was to turn thoughts and ideas into television in a way that made them easier to understand.
Canadians are used to seeing their money squandered because of fights between politicians, fights between different levels of government, even fights between departments within the same government.
$50 million. Malling exposed government waste. But he liked to pick apart the big picture, too, and show viewers how the whole country could be changed by looking at a problem with fresh eyes.
So this, of course, resulted in a series of programs, most famous of which is the one about New Zealand, which got the most attention. New Zealand at the time was in big financial trouble and had to take very drastic measures to recover its economy.
Here on Clonburn Road, Earl and Mary Bowers have roses year-round. But when it rains, raw sewage from the ditch behind overflows into the garden, and with it comes diarrhea, impetigo, the threat of typhoid.
We got used condoms.
In your garden?
In toilet garden, paper. Right across.
I mean, what did council say when you wanted it fixed?
They now had no money to do it.
Malling's particular talent was that he could pick the little vignette to illustrate a broader problem. The most famous of the New Zealand is shooting the hippo.
Across town at the Auckland City Zoo, a blessed event last spring. You think kittens are cute. What about a baby hippo? Kids were in love with it.
I am very, very sad that the zookeeper has shot the hippo.
What? Shoot the baby hippo? That's right. No room at the zoo. And they couldn't expand the hippo pen because the government has no money.
What Eric brought to the table in some of his storytelling was the whole debate about national debt. And Eric so focused the country on it, his famous story about New Zealand basically hitting the brink of bankruptcy. And people started to take that so seriously that, you know, right after that, the federal government started paying down the debt. We became debt conscious. And to the point where, I mean, I'd still in the national conversation today, you know, my God, we've got to balance the budget. I mean, that was driven by the journalism that was on W5.
It's been 14 years since the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Another personality who made history on the program was Carol Taylor. In 1974, she was the first reporter to interview Margaret Trudeau in depth. But it almost didn't happen.
Just before we did the interview, I got a call saying that, in fact, she'd been admitted to hospital, and no one knew about it. And if I would not go public with that information, they promised me as soon as she got out, I would get the first interview.
Keeping quiet about Margaret's admission to hospital was one thing, but Carol Taylor also knew the Prime Minister's wife was suffering from mental illness.
And so I'm sure some journalism schools would say that, well, you should have gone straight to the headline that night. You would have been, a big story. But I honored her request and also had great sympathy for what she was going through and had no idea if she really would do the interview eventually or not. And wouldn't tell my bosses what was going on, nothing. And when she got out, she called. We set it up and we did it really quickly.
What led up to your getting psychiatric help?
I needed help because I was really at that time reaching a kind of a crisis stage in my life when I was after the election, the letdown after the election campaign. I found myself very thoughtful about what I as a human being could do in the next while at my husband's side.
W5 continued to follow the Trudeau family throughout the years. The ups and downs of Margaret's life, the tragedy of her youngest son, Michelle's, death in 1998.
I mean, this is just so spectacularly beautiful. You can understand why people would want to come back here to ski.
Oh, my God, yeah. Every time I've been here.
In 2002, Tom Clark took the future Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau, back to the place in British Columbia where his brother had been swept away by an avalanche.
Misha and Andy laid down flat on the path as the snow came down, swept them down the hill, dropped Andy sort of off to the side just at the edge of the water, and carried Misha out, 100 feet into the middle of the lake.
In a moment, prison guards encased from head to toe in bite-proof, scratch-proof suits of armor.
It wasn't safe, was it?
No, not at all.
You're sick in the morning, you wake up, you want a shot.
Healthcare in Canada costs around $144 billion of our tax dollars every year. And it's increasing faster than our incomes. So W5 is watching closely how wisely those health dollars are spent, spotting trends in medicine, exposing flaws, and looking at ways to make the system more efficient. And often, the program is there before anyone else.
Prison guards encased from head to toe in bite-proof, scratch-proof suits of armor. It's protection against catching AIDS from an inmate.
W5 broke ground in 1985 with the first in-depth look at AIDS in Canada and around the world. At the time, there was much fear and a lot of ignorance about how the disease was spread and how people were affected.
But it was very important to try to educate people that you didn't get AIDS just easily. You had to really have a transfer of fluids. And if you took care of that, then the epidemic could be slowed down dramatically.
Mark took me back to his old haunts to see if the AIDS scare had caught up with his junkie friends.
McIntosh entered the murky world of heroin at what was known as a shooting gallery in New York City and showed viewers how the disease could be spread when addicts shared needles.
Hey, if anybody's gonna get AIDS, if you can get it from blood, it's me. I never wash my arms, and I sweat all day, That dirt going into your veins gotta be awful. Ew.
I mean, think of it. The immediacy is getting a shot. Thinking about 2 years in the future is nothing. I mean, you can't think that far ahead. You're sick in the morning, you wake up, you want a shot.
Did things change after that?
Well, not only to think about it, but it was more open to talk about. And people very quickly started saying, well, is that true? Is that not true? And I think the public, as always, will sort themselves out and then demand from their politicians some movement.
7 of every 10 AIDS victims are homosexuals. The epidemic first surfaced in New York, where 400 people had died from it.
W5 takes large-scale medical issues like AIDS and tries to humanize them by telling the story of those afflicted.
I considered suicide for a while. I think at one point, if it hadn't been for my family and friends and people that I care a lot about, who I know would be very hurt, I would have.
Our viewers also learn of new medical techniques through personal journeys.
This is Bertrand Proulx, a 24-year-old Quebec truck driver who lived for 3 years in helpless, hopeless despair. His spinal cord cut in an accident, paralyzed from the shoulders down. Now he may well walk again, thanks to a medical miracle performed by a 73-year-old Toronto surgeon, Dr. Gordon Murray.
But this is the first time anything comparable to this has ever taken place.
That's never been done before. That's in complete regeneration, or with complete interruption of the spinal cord to get regeneration of it.
Through her typing, Carly had unexpectedly found her voice. And she had a surprising and powerful story to tell.
I am an autistic girl who has learned to spell and can't help people to stop looking at me like I am helpless.
Over the following months, Carly started writing about her feelings, about how all along she'd understood what her family was saying, and how she was trying hard to control her behaviors.
I try very hard to act appropriately. It's so tough to do when people think it's easy because they don't know what is going on in my body.
Cell phone cameras captured the chaos in the food court. A man with a gun and an axe to grind opened fire on the unsuspecting, leaving victims wounded on the floor.
We saw the blood in Connor's hair up in his head, and it started to gather there, and then it started to run down his face.
Her little brother, 13-year-old Connor, had been shot in the head. A 3-hour surgery removed the bullet and part of the bone in his skull so his brain, pierced by shrapnel, could swell, then hopefully heal.
Did you know you had been shot?
Kind of felt weird, and then I felt the blood, I guess. And then I'm like, I might be, I don't know.
He's at Toronto's Hospital for Sick Children for a dramatic procedure rarely offered to young people. Doctors plan to remove 90% of his stomach. Dr. Jacob Langer is Brendan's surgeon.
Safety is our primary concern with this operation.
W5 was the first to report on a controversial treatment for multiple sclerosis that was developed in Italy. It's known as the liberation therapy.
So using ultrasound, he began to scan the head and necks of MS patients, and that's when he made a key discovery.
In some patients, I found the evidence of narrowing of the vein.
In the neck?
Yes.
So the blood was not draining, and this is in an MS patient?
Yes, just in MS patients.
In patient after patient, he found the same thing, narrowed veins.
So in normal people or people with other diseases?
With other disease, neurological or not.
No narrowing?
No narrowing.
So every single one
yes.
of the MS patients had some sort of narrowing in the drainage.
Yes.
It was a brand new condition, something he called CCSVI, chronic cerebral spinal venous insufficiency. He found blockages either in the two jugular veins or in a large central vein that sits in the chest, problems that he says likely take root before birth. And when they're narrowed or blocked, blood backs up into the brain, and that, he says, could be pushing blood which contains iron into the brain tissue of these patients. The bottom line, Dr. Zamboni had uncovered a structural defect common in MS patients that could be a possible trigger for multiple sclerosis. This is home video after the procedure.
Well, I felt warmness or a difference in my left side of my face, and I thought I'd just try and wiggle my toes. So I did, and it moved.
Oh, this is so awesome.
Then I thought about my left hand.
And there is the left hand.
One of the nurses came over, said, are you all right? And I said, I'm fine, shake my hand. And she shook my left hand, which was useless before.
It was quite remarkable.
The question as a physician, though, is it a placebo effect or is it real? I mean, when a patient really wants to get better, sometimes when you do something, they seem to feel better. And it really comes down to, over time, assessing whether or not his improvements are real and will be a lasting. And who knows?
Hey, good morning, baby. Hey, you look awful good.
This is Annette today at her home in California.
I'll help her do your hair, okay?
She's now 70 years old. She lost the ability to walk 8 years ago, stopped speaking nearly 3 years ago.
Hey, baby. Hey, baby. Okay. Just go slow, baby.
She has 24-hour nursing care.
There we go. Here, baby, let me put your glasses on.
But Annette's primary caregiver is her husband, Glenn. He's now 81.
She's my wife. I love her. Here, I'll take care of her. I don't regret it by one iota. When we got married, we promised we would take care of each other. Come hell or high water, you know. And when she was diagnosed and started all this stuff about MS, I told her, I said, well, I'll take care of you, honey, and I'll do everything I can do. I love you. I love you, baby. I just tell her, hey, you're my baby. You want to go to the ranch today, baby, and go for a ride, huh? We'll go out and take a look around, okay? A big, nice look at me with those big, brown, bright eyes is telling me thank you.
At Tri-City Medical Center in California, interventional radiologist Don Ponick had also heard about CCSVI. In fact, he'd started treating MS patients with this novel approach.
But you're intrigued.
Oh, very much so. I mean, we think there's something going on. We don't know exactly what, but there's something going on.
In a recent study, he and colleagues tested over 250 MS patients. Most had blocked blood veins. And when doctors restored blood flow by opening small balloons inside the veins, about half of the patients reported some of their symptoms were lessened or gone 6 months after treatment. And there were few side effects. Glenn asked Dr. Ponick to test Annette.
So that's her head up
yes.
at the top.
So this is her chin, and she's facing this way toward the left.
Scans showed Annette had the same unusual problems being found in others with MS.
And we can see a very tight narrowing there.
He said she just had 30% of normal blood flow out of the right jugular vein, and the left jugular vein was completely blocked.
So, Avis, where do we stand now with this liberation therapy?
Well, it's been quite a journey. We've learned a lot of things. Number one, we found how unhappy MS patients are with the status quo in terms of the treatment and the understanding of their illness. We saw the rise of social media, where all these unhappy patients came together and started to agitate for research and for treatment. It's a phenomenon that's been studied by scientists. It was so profound. We've also seen, we've had front row seats at the messy and political side of science, because you had neurologists very unhappy with the story, calling CTV on mischief for airing it. And then you had vascular doctors who were brought into it who thought it was quite logical. They restore blood flow to other parts of the body, why not the brain? So we've had 6 years of research. The bulk of it seems not to find a connection between impaired blood flow and MS. But there are a host of studies that do suggest impaired flow in there might be responsible not just for MS, but possibly for other brain diseases.
So where does all this go from here?
Well, we are waiting for two key studies that I can see, one from British Columbia, the other one from Italy, that will give us a clearer picture. I should add that Dr. Zamboni was hired by NASA to do studies on brain flow in zero gravity. I think, you know, science is not a straight line, and we're watching the to and fro. It could take a decade for us to really understand the importance and the role of blood flow in the brain.
Why did it happen? Why did I put him here?
From the beginning, W5 has had its finger on the pulse of change in healthcare, tracking down those stories that affect families at every age. They often raise tough questions with no easy answers. And one of the most disturbing these days is the ongoing controversy over the treatment of elderly people in nursing homes.
You thought you were putting your husband in a safe place.
Yes.
It wasn't safe, was it?
No, not at all. Not at all.
Frank's room looked like a scene from a horror film. Blood splattered everywhere. And nearby, another elderly resident was found washing the blood off her hands. Frank's blood.
Could you possibly have kept Frank Alexander safe? Could you have prevented Joe McLeod from hurting Frank Alexander?
No, I couldn't tell you that I could totally prevent that from happening.
Nothing like what was captured on the night of May the 7th, 2013, when this PSW struggles with Helen trying to force her out of bed and pulling down on her neck. The worker handles her forcefully and pins down her wrist. Helen appears to be screaming in pain.
In a moment.
It's difficult to imagine any justification for the beating of Tyler Archer.
Nobody's ever came out of Stratford, Ontario and been famous.
You came here to have sex with a 12-year-old girl?
Every year across this country, judges preside over about 1.5 million criminal and civil cases in courtrooms just like this one. So, not surprisingly, crime, justice, and injustice have been a productive hunting ground for W5 stories. Stories presented in that special W5 manner, taking the viewer inside the issue and putting a human face to the victims of crimes and those who commit them.
Our 22-year-old student decoy, posing as a 12-year-old, lets him in.
Take your shoes off.
It's time for W5 to show its hand.
Hey, Ron.
Hello.
How you doing?
Pretty good.
Want to have a seat for a minute?
And to our surprise, he does. Remember, he's here expecting to have sex with a 12-year-old girl.
Who are you here to see?
Pardon me?
Who are you here to see?
The owner of the house.
Katie?
Yeah. Is she the owner of the house, though?
Do you know she's 12 years old?
No.
You've been chatting to her online.
Yeah.
12-year-old girl.
Oh, I didn't know that. It doesn't say that.
It says it right here. I've got the chat logs. You came here to have sex with a 12-year-old girl?
Put your hands behind your back.
I remember them telling me to get my hands behind my back, and I was trying to, but it was kind of awkward. Like, I'd be right on my face.
How does that work? If you're on your hands and knees,
yes.
How do you put your hands behind your back?
I don't know. I tried to do my best.
The best he could, anyway, in the 3 seconds Bowser gave him to comply.
Put your hands behind your back.
It's difficult to imagine any justification for the beating of Tyler Archer. Constable Bowser claimed he was resisting, but he was never charged with anything and was simply released about half an hour later.
You are watching security camera video of a crime in progress. It happened in 2014 in a truck yard just north of Toronto. Those men you see are thieves. Police don't know how they got into the yard, perhaps just scaled the fence. They quickly and methodically choose their target. They bypass the ignition, get it started, and drive out before police arrive. The fence, no impediment. They simply drive through it. The case, still unsolved. Think it's unusual? It's happening pretty well every day. Latest estimates, cargo theft is costing the Canadian economy at least $5 billion a year.
It's all about telling great stories, and people are using whatever technology they can to see it. Sure, we've improved the cameras. You can see the pictures. The visuals are much more spectacular. The hidden camera equipment is now, you can get one that's as big as my thumb, and you can put it almost anywhere, so it's easier to go and do those kinds of things.
Yes, everything is good. The back is, engine is good, everything.
Hidden cameras transform the way W5 investigates the car business. In 1997, we joined forces with the APA, the Automobile Protection Association. And often, those annual reports led to changes in the laws that protect you, the consumer.
This has been split, and here,
So this car was in a significant frontal impact. It actually goes back, I believe, to the roof even.
And at Brampton Mazda, the APA discovered that the manufacturer charges $105 extra for every color, except for one shade of blue on their vans.
The APA's secret weapon on this mission, an expert mechanic, his identity hidden, who can spot a previously damaged vehicle from 50 paces. He's not fooled by a shiny new paint job. It doesn't take him long to spot trouble, serious trouble.
Yeah. The Corolla might actually be cut in half.
Unbelievable. It's a weld. The car was cut going all the way across, and it's not a pretty repair.
Remember those 420 trucks in stock? Well, you'd think one of them has to be the truck in the ad. All the same, the salesman is having a hard time finding it. It's almost as if he's checking every single vehicle on the lot. But finally, he returns, and guess what? The truck in the ad is already gone.
Well, my name is Victor Malarek. I'm with CTV W5.
Get that camera off me. Let's get the camera off me.
The interesting part is that people like to know what's going on so that they can carry on their lives. And they can turn to a variety of programs to try to get that information. But I believe that the ones that they trust most are the public affairs program that spend money, have quality people, and they work hard at getting the story right.
Do you approve of public affairs television?
Y'all, are they having affairs in public on television? That's the limit.
W5 is a serious program, of course. That's what viewers expect. But it isn't all about scams and scandals. We also like to visit the entertainment industry and show celebrities in a different light.
I mean that kind of show. Well, and the other one they have, Jarrett and the Chanel number 9, they have the WC.
W5.
Is that a 5? I wonder why they kept putting it backwards. My God. Oh, that's W5. Oh, that was WC.
What do you mean by peace?
Just all its aspects. Peace of mind, peace in the street, peace in your own home, peace throughout the world, really means no violence or violence that's channeled and doesn't hurt.
Where would you say you're most proud of your contribution to the world?
One thing that people always come up to me and the other guys in the Beatles and say is, you really saved my life. I was in college. And I was going through the worst time, but your music got me through it. Or I was ill. You know, there have been quite a few cases like that, and your music got me through it. You know, you gave me some hope.
The $95 million Coliseum at Caesar's Palace seats 4,000 people and was custom built for this show, designed to best showcase Celine and her powerful voice.
Once everything is there, the cards are all on the table, talking Vegas, talking cards,
yeah.
Everything is there. It was taking chances, but I don't think we were taking a risk. If you don't take chances in life, you'll never know if it's going to work or not.
I started at the age of 6. I've done nothing else but write, direct, whatever, involving entertainment, theater, movies, whatever. I've never done anything else but try and make you smile or laugh or cry.
Walking down the gravel road, trying to think of higher things, trying to shift my heavy load.
And it always seemed that cowboys and the West were in your DNA. How did that happen? Where did that start for you?
I've always been kind of an outsider. A lot of cowboys are, you know, or they wouldn't be cowboys. It's been a great party, but, you know, can't go on forever.
And you were good at that, eh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Still am. Still am.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Sometimes we find people on the way up and introduce them to viewers before they become household names.
Were you just born with this plastic face?
I guess. Always hamming it up, you know? Just sort of came natural. I didn't know until like a year ago that was different than everybody else. That my face was so weird. I realized that's what my special thing is, I guess, is that I'm weird.
You've got the reputation of just being the nicest all-Canadian kid. Are you really that nice? Or is this just a big show that we're seeing?
Well, you stumped me.
Well, don't you ever swear at somebody or kick them in the shins or get cheesed right off?
I'm sure I can be
as bad as somebody else. I'm sure I can get mad and swear at somebody and that kind of thing. But it's like I said before, I know people are always going to be watching me, and they're always going to watch my every move.
I think we all have a natural sort of pulse inside us, and I think that the feeling of that swing, that you either feel it or you don't, and I feel it in a great big way.
It basically gave others like hope, because I come from basically somewhere that nothing really comes from there, like nothing, like nobody's ever came out of Stratford, Ontario and been famous or...
Wait, Lloyd Robertson has come out of Stratford, Ontario and been famous. He anchors the national news on CTV.
I'm just saying there hasn't been somebody to come out and be known worldwide.
We'll bring you an inside report on this week's events at the University of New Brunswick in Fredericton, and we'll build an instant TV set before your very eyes.
Profiles of celebrities are just one of the lighter sides of W5. We also like to show you how a bunch of serious journalists can sometimes just kick back and have fun.
It's the Mediterranean town of Cap d'Agde, located in the south of France near the Spanish border. It has everything most cities have. But a visitor quickly realizes there is something quite different here that sets this place apart from hundreds of other such resort cities. They're all naked. We wondered why they do it.
Well, I explain that it's just natural. I mean, you were born with no clothes on, and it seems to be perfectly natural to go around without clothes on, in the right weather, obviously.
It's all very well for the people here, true naturists, to let it all hang out. But as for me, there's just so far that my producers will allow me to go to get to the bottom of a story.
Yeah, oh, hi, Elvis, how are you? Listen, King, I have someone here who'd like to talk to you. Do you mind? Do you mind speaking to him? It's Elvis. Elvis?
Yeah, it's me. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Do you mind if I call you Elvis?
Well, no, you call me Elvis because that's my name.
Oh, that's great. Could you, like, hum a few bars or something, or sing, or do something that would have people believe that it's actually Elvis that they're...
Don't. That's what you say.
If I dare.
So Her Highness, Princess Suhe, and the Dark Angel offer to show me a few moves.
If you're serious, we're not joking. It's at your own risk.
Foolishly, I agree, figuring I'd be gentle. It started with a sting. And before I knew it, I felt like I was caught up in a Sudbury Saturday night bar brawl. The tag team flew through the air and pummeled me with not one, but a double flying plancha.
I was once told by one of our publicists who said, you know, you got to remember that you don't want to tell people that W5 of today is the program or their grandparents, because it isn't really. W5 is relevant to each generation that comes along, and that's one of the things that has helped. You know, the hosts have changed, the stories have changed, the stories we tell change along with the society. And that's why it stays relevant, and that's, I think, why it survived.
So on behalf of Ken Cavanaugh, myself, and everybody else on W5, Doug Johnson, good night.
I'm Jim Reed for W5. Good night.
I'm Eric Malling.
Good night.
Jack McGaw for W5. Good night.
I'm Carol Taylor.
I'm Barry Dunsmore. Good night.
Good night. For Jim Reed, Henry Champ, and me, Helen Hutchinson, good night for W5.
And I'm Lloyd Robertson. And that's the kind of 50 years it's been for W5. All right?
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah.